Ladies and gentlemen, I want to welcome everyone to today's webinar. Today's webinar is actually produced in partnership with the Sports Events and Tourism Association, or Sports ETA, and thus it is appropriately titled Legalized Sports Betting in America and What It Means for Your Industry and Destination. Today, we are excited to discuss how sports events and tourism professionals can harness the new revenue and promotional aspects of legalized sports betting while understanding the importance of integrity in sporting events and the safeguards to have in place for all stakeholders. So before we get started today, I wanted to share a promotional code that we have for all Sports ETA members. That's Sports ETA, all caps. It's good for 15% off the three-course master certification bundle available right now at sportsgamblingeducation.com. I'd like to take this time to not only introduce, but thank today's panelists, all three of which are proud Ohio University alumni, and they're all active members as well of this sports gambling education program community. So first up, hosting today's webinar is Jim Kahler. Jim is the director of sports gambling education at Ohio University with over 40 years of experience in the sports business industry and academia. He was also the founding director of the AECOM Center for Sports Administration. And this center is one that links faculty, students, and alumni to sports-related organizations and businesses, emphasizing research and harnessing knowledge to benefit the industry. Joining today's panel is Jackie Reau, CEO of Game Day, which is a media and marketing agency founded in 2002, specializing in sports, entertainment, and hospitality industries. And they do that by providing strategic communications counsel, crisis communications, event marketing and staffing, and digital and social content strategies. In 2020, Game Day added capabilities to support the legalized sports betting industry and esports. And of note, Jackie is also a graduate of this SGE Master Certification Program. And last but certainly not least, Sara Slane has also joined us for the panel today. Sara is the founder of Slane Advisory, where she's a leading consultant in the world of legalized sports betting and provides strategic planning, business development, and public positioning for all stakeholders from gaming, media, and sports. She's been dubbed the face of legalized sports betting for her lobbying of Congress and the U.S. Supreme Court to deem the PASPA, the Professional and Amateur Sports Protection Act, as unconstitutional. Sara was formerly the Senior Vice President of Public Affairs at the American Gaming Association, the AGA, and in this role, she oversaw the AGA communications, government relations, ally development, research, and campaign style public affairs initiatives. She has also graciously lent her time and expertise to this program, at this SGE program, as both a lecturer and a webinar panelist. So, for all of today's attendees, please put your questions into the Q&A panel located at the bottom of our Zoom interface here. And without further ado, I would like to turn it over to today's host, Jim Kahler.
Thanks, Scott. And it's good to be back with two dear friends in Jackie and Sara. But Jackie, I'm going to start with you. Some of our regular listeners might be less familiar with Sports ETA. So I know your company does a lot of work with Sports ETA. Can you give them maybe a thumbnail sketch of the organization?
Sure, Jim, I'd be happy to. Sports ETA is the Industry Association for the Sports Events Tourism Association. So representing over 550 destinations around America, and whether that's a sports commission, a convention and visitors bureau, an event rights owner, an allied industry member. So a lot of what they do is networking events, education events, of course, research and advocacy. So this topic is of great interest to Sports ETA under the leadership of Al Kidd, who's the CEO and president of Sports ETA. And really the position of Sports ETA for legalized sports gambling is to educate, not to advocate either way, but really just to educate folks what is happening in the industry in America, but then state by state as well, because there are many of the states, over 35 US states, have state associations that represent the sports commissions or the sports destinations in those states. So this is a very hot topic, and I'm excited that so many people were interested in the partnership with Sports ETA and Ohio University.
And for some of our listeners, it's really an outgrowth of the old National Association of Sports Commissions. So LKID has really expanded it and made the association much bigger, correct?
Yeah, that's right, Jim. The NASC has been was around for 25 years, and when Al came in, he really started to see that the membership was growing and wanted to be more inclusive. So the rebrand took place a couple years ago, and that really introduced the association to parks and recreation commissions that are so important. And then just new events, rights holders in the space, and then also industry partners, whether it's facilities, venues, research partners, economic development partners, and the like.
Good. And Sara, it's good to have you back on one of our webinars. It's been a while, but in terms of growing, I think the last time you and I were together was early first quarter, but could you share with our audience some additional growth states that maybe have adopted regulated sports gambling and ones that are getting close to the finish line? Just maybe kind of a quick industry update.
Sure. Yeah, and good to be here. And thank you so much for having me again. I love being with my fellow Bobcats, so it's great. Yeah, it's been unbelievable. The explosion of sports betting across the United States just continues. We just saw more recently this year, Maryland enacts legislation. They'd passed a statewide referendum overwhelmingly last November, and then the supporting legislation went into place in March, I believe. So we expect that Maryland will have legalized sports betting either fourth quarter 2021 or first quarter 2022. Louisiana was another state that had a referendum, and then legislation has been passed. So that was voted on by a parish-by-parish instance. And so there'll be mobile sports betting in New Orleans. And again, expect that hopefully later this year, if not early next year, we'll see that take place. We still have a few states out there that are contemplating legislation, including Ohio. Saw a bill advanced today, and I think pretty bullish that Ohio will adopt and enact legislation. Probably won't have sports betting up and running until next year. But again, another state that has been discussing and debating sports betting since the fall of PASPA in 2018, but seems to be advancing in the right direction, and expects, again, legalization to occur. I think some big surprising states that did move legislation forward were New York and Florida. I often referred to these big states like New York and Florida and Texas and California as sort of the brass ring for the gaming industry, just given their size and volume. New York did enact legislation this year as well. They're in the process right now. We'll be conducting an RFP for access into that state. So we'll see how that all rolls out. Again, don't anticipate. I think everyone always puts out there having legal sports betting by the Super Bowl. I will see. I will see if that ends up happening. They haven't issued their RFP or RFA yet, but hopefully that'll get done by next February, as well as the state of Florida. Florida has a big, powerful tribe called the Seminole Tribe, who has a partnership with Hard Rock Casinos. Seminole did ratify their compacts with the state of Florida, and the legislature did enact and approve the compact, which allows for legal sports betting, online sports betting in that state. There's been some question around legality and maybe some possible referendum challenges. So we'll see how that all ends up shaking out. But if things go according to plan, expect, and the Seminole Tribe and Hard Rock Casino has pronounced that they will have sports betting up and running again by football season, I think maybe in October.
Okay, thank you. So what do you think the magic number will grow to by year end? if you're just sharing total number of states?
It's a really good question. Probably I would say 30 all in, 30, 31, which is incredible. And look, it doesn't fall too far out of line as to how many states have legal casino and or lottery gaming or tribal gaming. I think we're up to 43 states or 44 states. So that sports betting piece is really starting to mirror legal online. There's going to be my dog. I knew my dog was going to make an appearance at some point in time, to mirror the casino gaming industry and that footprint throughout the United States. It's just happening, I think, at a lot faster clip than anyone had anticipated, which is great. It's great.
Cool. Well, Jackie, I want to start our panel discussion with you, but with the legislation and regulation of legalized sports gambling comes opportunity. So for us at Ohio University, we saw an opportunity in educating individuals about it. That's how SGE was formed. But from a sports ETA standpoint, when I say legalized sports gambling and opportunity, what's the first thing that comes into your mind?
Yeah, good question, Jim. You know, a destination marketing organization, it has always been a resource, right? A resource for the community or a resource for the event's rights holder, and really that glue in a community. So, you know, they're usually one phone call away from everyone in the city, from the hoteliers to the restaurants to the event venue. So when I think about a couple things with legalized sports gambling. I think about those events or those athletes who might be coming into the market, who, you know, we need to ensure the integrity of the sport that they're coming in to play and make sure everyone's on the same page in terms of how that will operate. I think the other really exciting component is just the engagement that legalized sports gambling brings with a fan base. And so, you know, I'm in Cincinnati and I've worked in hospitality and entertainment here for over 20 years. So, you know, my mind is racing on just some new promotions we can do. You know, we have a Hard Rock Casino here that is rebranding. The sports book is ready to go the minute the lights flip on above Hard Rock Cafe. So, you know, what can we do with a partner like that? What will the Cincinnati Reds do? What will the Cincinnati Bengals, FC Cincinnati do in terms of their approach and their partnership? So I think a destination marketing organization can really, first of all, educate themselves. Because as you said, I went through the Mass Certificate program during 2020, last couple months of 2020. And there were things in the program I hadn't even thought about, you know, in terms of TV rights or the integrity of the sport, you know, maintaining relationships with the operators, and just really the full enormity of this industry and what it can do in terms of engagement, new revenue streams, and new events for a destination.
Sarah, I want to go back to maybe your time with the American Gaming Association, but for years, Vegas was a destination because it was the place where you could go and gamble legally. So when you think of some of the tourism benefits to states coming on board, do you see, you know, places that have adopted it, that it's an added value? So if I now go over to see my good friend Jim Van Stone with the Washington Wizards or Capitals, he's got a sportsbook in Reno, so maybe that becomes more of a destination because of the addition of the sportsbook in the building.
Yeah, it's a really good question, and Vegas is it's such an interesting town. First of all, I think hands down, no offense, Jackie, I know you can't take sides in this, but such an amazing tourist destination for businesses and conventions. And oddly enough, yes, Las Vegas is the capital of casino gaming, I think, in the United States, but 50% of their revenue comes from the non-gaming amenities. So actually, I think it's higher than that now. So, you know, while people think that Las Vegas is such a big casino town, and that certainly is a huge driver of revenue and money for the operators, a lot of the revenue is coming from the hotel rooms, the retail, the sports books, the food, beverage, entertainment. And they've done just such an amazing job at packaging that all together. When you take the opposite scenario, when you go to a place like a casino in Toledo or Hollywood Casino in Columbus, it's the opposite. Actually, like 80% of the revenue that is coming out of that facility is from the gaming side and not necessarily from the amenity side. What do I think is going to happen now with sports betting is a few things. It certainly has now transitioned and pivoted the casino gaming industry, which was largely taking place in a brick and mortar fashion, to now digitizing the entire industry, which is really interesting. When it comes then to the actual F&B piece of this and tourism piece of it, you're seeing all sorts of interesting concepts happen now. In, you mentioned Washington, D.C. I actually was fortunate enough to go to the William Hill opening at Capital One a couple weeks ago, and they did an amazing job. It's beautiful. It's a two-story sports book. Upstairs has a really nice fine dining restaurant. I shouldn't say fine dining. It's a very high-end, nice restaurant. And then downstairs, they have the cash book, and they've got some kiosks. The other thing that they did, which I thought was really, really cool, was they put space aside for private events. And I live in Baltimore, and I was thinking to myself, oh my gosh, it'd be so much fun to get a group of people together to go to the hockey game or go to the basketball game. You could host a private event. You could turn this into, you know, a whole night of learning how to sports bet or having a bunch of people there. So I think there are these unique sort of opportunities that are going to really take off with creativity around tourism. As Jackie mentioned, she's in Cincinnati. You've got three professional teams that are there. I know they are all very seriously looking at the potential opportunity in the state and what that can mean for them. I was fortunate enough to work on a couple of these integrated now sportsbook deals with teams, including in Arizona. I worked with the Arizona Diamondbacks and NASCAR and the PGA Tour, and they're going to have now these integrated sportsbooks at those facilities. So you can imagine now sort of that rising tide that lifts all boats, in addition to hosting amazing events and people going for the waste management tournament. They're also going to probably hopefully plan around, you know, there's the sports book, and it's a great sort of entertainment component to that whole experience.
Yeah, and Jackie, you and I have had our share of experiences with sports commissions, but I'm excited to think about what future events a sports commission might be able to put together that centers around sports gambling. So I know, yeah, Vegas has done well over the years with some unique events like the National Handicap Thoroughbred Racing Association and people competing for the right to go there. So I got to believe if I'm at the table with the Cincinnati Sports Commission and it becomes legal, just a matter of time, we're like, okay, what kind of event could we put together that might help fund the sports commission?
Yeah, you're right, Jim. I see a whole portfolio of events right around those betting milestones, those sports, you know, let's start Super Bowl and March Madness, Masters, you know, All-Star games, all the way up to fantasy and NFL weekends. And in my mind, you know, I'm kind of going to, okay, what's a hotel partner look like? We better have, you know, 10 more TVs in the suite type of deal. You know, what is a really cool experience for the 12 guys that come to town and they want to golf, they want to get on the tee early before, you know, the Masters coverage starts? You know, how do I get them a tee time at one of our great clubs? How does Tom Browning, Mr. Perfect, the only pitcher to throw a perfect game in Reds history, join them for brunch? You know, those types of experiential things. Let them go to the sports book or mobile bet, whatever they want, and really keep them engaged that way. So, you know, we figure out, you know, whatever sport they're interested in and program the front end and the back end of when they really want to be engaged during that activity. Right. But Jim, while I have the floor, I'd love to ask Sara a question. If you are a state, Sara, that has not legalized sports gambling, I would love your thoughts on what's the 2, 3, 4 bullets that you would want to see in the perfect legislation, let's say, but to benefit a sports commission or a convention and visitors bureau, because we haven't seen a lot of that money come into the industry. It's traditionally still going in the education fund and gambling awareness and that. So I'd love your thoughts on that.
Yeah, it's a good question. And one in which I think the casino industry struggles with too is, you know, they generate a ton of tax revenue and where does that money end up going? And I think honestly, if you play the long game, you really do need to drive it back into tourism and into your conventions and into your convention facilities. And because if you take the example of Atlantic City, which generated billions of dollars in tax revenue, and a lot of it was pushed out throughout the state and not really honed back into the city itself. And they ended up losing. And there really needed to be more redevelopment back into the town. So I think, again, to your point around playing the long game of how do we make sure that some of those funds then are being driven back into tourism and CVBs and the lifeblood of, you know, the entertainment piece or the convention business for the city. You know, I think, again, you can make a compelling point as to why that needs to happen, why that redevelopment, reinvestment needs to happen in order to compete with other states. I don't have the perfect model because, to your point, like, it's really hard. I mean, dollars or tax dollars are super hard to fight for. You know that. Education and healthcare is a very compelling recipient of those dollars, especially when you're talking about a sin industry that is typically tied then back to funding education, certainly around the lottery, certainly around even commercial casino gaming. So it is a tricky one. I do know that there's been conversation, at least in North Carolina, and I think there was something similar in Texas where there was some sport reinvestment fund that then was going back into attracting events into the state. So, and keeping events in the state that were coming. So that is certainly a concept that's out there. I just can't promise that you're gonna be successful advocating for it because it's very hard to fight legislators over paying for education versus paying for, you know, what I think people view as a softer topic around tourism.
Sara, I'd like to stay with you for a second, but tax dollars may be hard to come by, but you've done some consulting with professional sports teams on the sponsorship side. So if I'm a sports commission, I could go out and put together a sponsorship with DraftKings or FanDuel or, you know, William Hill. So where do you see the opportunity there? Because those companies want to generate some goodwill in the community, and supporting something like a Cincinnati Sports Commission would seem to be an opportunity for that.
Yeah, I mean, I certainly think that helps. And I do think that as a new company in a state that is targeting your consumers, that wants to work with the CVB, wants to work with the local tourism commissions. I mean, I think a great example of that is, you know, the work that's being done right now in the Scottsdale and Phoenix area is really making sure that as part of these discussions and building retail sports books that haven't been there traditionally, that there's some sort of partnership between the operator then and the local tourism board, because you're right, like they are gonna be a new company coming in looking to attract the customer that you are so familiar with and you're so passionate about. And so I don't know about direct dollars. I mean, I think that there's always membership benefits in trying to solicit operators around that, for sure. I had not actually thought about the sponsorship piece, but I think it's an interesting concept.
Yeah, Jackie and I were talking earlier, but the one that I'm going to keep my eye on is this affiliate marketing partnership. For years, when I was on the Cleveland Sports Commission, we had a program with the License Plate Bureau. So if you got the Cavs logo on your plates, X amount of dollars went back to the Sports Commission. But if the Cincinnati Sports Commission can get you to open an account with DraftKings, I gotta believe there's some money there.
Yeah, affiliate marketing is certainly a pathway as well. And they are always looking for traffic being driven to them. They love that model because there's a direct ROI and they can prove that, you know, whatever partnership that they're doing is actually translating into real dollars. So I think that's a really, really interesting idea.
Yeah. So one more question for you, Sara, that's going to bring Jackie back in, but In Phoenix, the fact that the Waste Management Open can have a temporary sports book at the event, is that something that's carved into the legislation early on, or is it something that if you know, Jackie's bringing an LPGA championship back to Kings Island, that Ohio could do the same thing?
Yeah, it's actually not going to be temporary. It's going to be there 365. So DraftKings did the partnership with the PGA Tour for the Waste Management tournament. That will be one event that will take place, but they will have a 365 facility there at TPC Scottsdale.
Okay.
And yeah, that was part of the legislative process, that it actually, the sports betting licenses were awarded to the league and or team. And they then were given the ability to designate a sportsbook operator to operate the book as part of that license. So that would be part of a legislative piece, and it would tie back then to having an actual sportsbook license.
So Jackie, what events occur on a regular basis in Cincinnati, or maybe some new events that you're trying to bring to town that you'd love to have a sports book adjacent to?
Well, you know, there's this thoroughbred industry right across the river here. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that's really interesting to me. But I think the Ohio legislation, Sarah, correct me if I'm wrong, includes the PGA through the Memorial Tournament is similar to the Waste Management. So I think that's exciting for Ohio, because that's such a great event, and, you know, people who love golf go there. I think the other exciting parts are just, how are the professional teams going to embrace? And I think, you know, there's different levels of confidence and support. I think all of them are for it, but it'll be interesting to see how they really roll it out, at what degree and what level of risk that they take. So I'm excited about that. Again, a sports commission, in my opinion, is kind of the glue for the sports community, especially the events tourism part of it. And it's important for the membership to be informed of this industry, how it works, the you know, many, many intricate details, and then how they can serve as an advisor or a partner or someone at the table. So I think that's why this program is so important, Jim, the master certification at Ohio University. Just, I think, you know, in my opinion, every sports commission, every CVB who is going to be turning over legalized sports gambling initiatives should have somebody take this program.
Yeah.
And it's really important to know the industry, the ins and outs, what's a regulator versus an operator, but also just to ensure the integrity of sport that is happening in your community and how you can work with the operators to ensure that that integrity takes place. So, And Sarah, I don't know, we've talked about this before, but I have in my head this role in a sports commission that's like the assistant director of events / he or she is now the sports integrity officer within their commission, just to, again, be aware of what's happening in the industry and be that go-to person for their local community, but also events rights holders who are coming into the market.
And Jackie, that's a segue to something we were talking about earlier. As college athletics gets more in step with legalized sports gambling, it'll happen over time. But if you are working with Xavier in Cincinnati to bring the Midwest regionals back to Cincinnati, there's opportunity there, but there's also integrity. Mm-hmm. and getting up to speed on everything that's going on. I know Congress is looking at name, image, and likeness today, but sports gambling is only going to get bigger in and around collegiate events.
Yeah, I mean, Jim, I think you brought it up in one of the first modules of the program, but, you know, if I'm, you know, just at a Starbucks on Xavier's campus and I see, oh, there's the point guard, you know, because he's, you know, everyone knows him, he's popular, right? He's got a boot on his foot. Nobody said that. I didn't see him get hurt last night against Villanova. You know, is he going to play against Creighton Saturday?
Yeah.
And you got some insider information, and I walk up to him and I say, "Hey, what's going on with your foot? You okay?" Yeah, oh, I've got to keep this boot on for a week. Oh, okay.
Yeah, you know, you and I as educators, because I know you're on the faculty at UC, is like, we see that kid coming in the class with an ice bag on his knee or limping. I mean, mm-hmm. we've got to be careful.
Absolutely. And the other 30 kids who are in class with them mm-hmm. are going to see that. And they're going to be taking a photo of that and tweeting that out, or, you know, and social media is just the rapid fire of it. It scares me with the integrity issues that could go around that. So that's why I think this program is so important for the industry.
Yeah. Sara, I want to go back to something we talked about earlier, legislation before states adopt sports gambling. But how much, I mean, if you're looking into the future now that we've got so many states on board, are the owners of professional sports teams going to start to get some momentum behind the idea of having a sports book in their facility?
Yeah, 100%. I think I refer to it as Arizona Envy. I think that is the model now that I think a lot of the teams want to recreate and emulate, because it really is, if you think about the top of like the food chain of value for the casino operators, from a sports perspective, to hold the keys for market access into the state is very enticing. Number one. Number two is just, like I said, that whole synergistic element now of having a sports book inside or near or around, depending on which league you're dealing with, the arena. It's a rising tide that lifts all boats. You know, that was something that was super appealing to Monumental, was just that outside of those game days, how do you attract people into this building, you know, this multi-million dollar building that just sits vacant the entire time? So, William Hill they're the first sports book that's open in the US right now inside an arena. They did a great job. It's street facing. It's really easy access. I used to actually work in that area. It's a high traffic area, public transportation right there, parking readily available. So, you know, I think that the goal, and I think what's so appealing from an owner perspective is, again, like just driving more traffic into that facility around something that is synergistic to what you're offering.
Yeah, and early in my career, I came out of the arena industry, but dark dates were always like, what can we do with our dates that are just going to go dark? And Jackie, I was thinking about that the other day. Top Golf has gone out on tour to different stadiums. So if the Reds were to have a sports book in the stadium and you had a Top Golf challenge, you know, somebody gets a hole in one or whatever, but to actually have a sports book going at the same time, that could make for a much bigger event.
Absolutely. I was literally just thinking about where a Topgolf could go on the Ohio Riverfront the other day. I will tell you, I was not, personally, I was not as interested in a golf outing as a couple weeks ago, because I was in Michigan watching Phil's great win. But when you have a couple bucks on it, yeah, all of a sudden you're watching wall to wall, you're engaged. I'm watching the TV commercials, you know, it's the engagement process of sports betting. And I don't, you know, you don't have to be betting $1,000 for, you know, Phil to win, but you know, the $2, the $4 bet, I think it's just, it's fun. It's interesting. And it's such a new engagement tool that I believe these sports teams need now more than ever.
Yeah. And Sara, back to you, what, if you're looking into your crystal ball, what new sports will we be gambling on over the next decades? I'm thinking of Jackie. Her company has worked for years on putting on the Cincinnati Flying Pig Marathon. Are we going to start seeing bets?
What is that?
You
pray tell. What is the Flying Pig
Marathon? Cincinnati's Marathon. It's always the first Sunday in May. Of course, not this year. It'll be October 31st. But it's Cincinnati was called Porkopolis back in the 1800s for its pork industry. So we have flying pigs.
Did not know that. That's crazy.
But are we going to see gambling on events like marathons?
I don't think so.
No.
The reason why, yeah. I mean, first of all, an operator would have to price that, and they would need to know, like, how do you statistically even do that? It would be tough. I mean, look, do I think it, among friends, of course, like maybe, yeah. I still think it's a tough one.
How about events like a market going after the NCAA Final Four in women's volleyball? I mean, is that? Sure.
Oh yeah, no, that's already happening.
Yeah.
Collegiate sports across the board, men's, women's, as long as it's sanctioned and there is oversight, when you talk about integrity, that being such a critical component of all of this, that there's accountability and there's assurances that, you know, everything that is being done can be done in order to protect the integrity of the game, the commission will approve then betting on that sport or activity. Everything has to go before a gaming commission in order then to allow for betting on it, because that is to protect and promote the integrity of the sport. So I worked with Drone Racing League a couple months ago when they were, so that's sort of an interesting niche one that's out there. They had not had betting on drone racing before, and we had to approach a bunch of the gaming commissions then and ask for permission to allow the operators then to offer those kinds of bets on that sport. And it's a really thorough process. Like, you have to be able to prove that you have some sort of sanctioning committee, that there isn't any cheating, that there wouldn't be the opportunity or capability to, because of COVID, they had simulated races. So everything was being done electronically, that they're, you know, everything's being monitored in a way that can ensure the integrity around that bet. So, you know, the fly-by-night kind of betting on certain random events, I don't really see happening. I mean, there's been some really interesting ones. I think DraftKings offered a promotion on the Nathan's hot dog eating contest. But again, you've got to work with your gaming regulator to get that approved. And not all gaming regulators. We had a couple that said, you know, no to betting on it. So it goes to the core of promoting that integrity and promoting and protecting the consumer.
Okay. And Jackie, when I think of working with regulators, I also think of in the early process of putting a bid together for a national event, it's become so competitive in the United States that if you have a gambling regulator that's going to allow you to put that in part of your bid process to make the event bigger, that's going to strengthen your bid.
I actually just did add that into our bid for just a letter of intent that we were interested, a letter of interest for Rugby World Cup 2027 or 2028, and you know, basically said Ohio should have legalized gambling by 2028, I would hope. So, you know, I think that's a really important point. But I think also there are some organizations that might be a negative, that you have legalized sports gambling. And so, again, the stance of Sports ETA as an industry association is education only, right? Not advocating yes or no, legal or not legal. But I think at the end of the day, it's just so important to understand the industry and how it can or cannot be effective in your market, right? Everyone who's on this call who's interested in their destination knows their destination inside and out, as they should. The next level is, okay, how does legalized sports gambling help us, or how can it negatively, if at all, impact us? So I think that's the beauty of this program, is it just gives you a lot of resources to stay current with the industry, because as Sara said, I mean, she's got an encyclopedia knowledge because this is, you know, she's been working on this so long. We do not. So we need these resources that the Ohio University program provides. Just to stay up to date on this, you know, every week there's something new.
Yeah. Sara, I want to go back to this concept of working with the regulators, but if I'm the head of my sports commission, I'm going after an event and I would like to see the event get regulated and allowed to be bet on, I might also be going after a sports book to be a major sponsor of that event to help bring it to our city. So is that something that you would have to bundle up and put in front of your regulator, or how would somebody work through that model?
Yeah, so it depends. On a state-by-state basis, sometimes the sport has to approach the gaming commission to ask for permission, and sometimes an operator has to approach the gaming commission for permission to allow for betting on that activity. New Jersey, for example, the team or sport, like I worked with Premier Lacrosse League, they had to pursue New Jersey Division of Gaming Enforcement and asked for permission to allow for betting on lacrosse, professional lacrosse. In Nevada, a book like William Hill would have to go to the Nevada Division of the Nevada Gaming Commission and ask for permission on betting on that event. And so a sponsorship is not going to occur likely with a gaming operator unless they're going to see some sort of ROI back from that. All the operators have different sort of business models and the way that they think around that. DraftKings tends to be, I think, a little bit more forward-leaning on sponsoring events that are not like traditional sports. Like I said, they allowed for the Nathan's Hot Dog, the betting on that. I think they did a sponsorship package with around that. I'm sure they did. Not all operators are interested in that. They are, you know, probably more interested in traditional stick and ball sports. And so it just would depend on the kind of framework that the event was pushing forward.
Okay. Jackie, as we start to work with you and help educate the association, you and I were talking earlier about the whole idea of also understanding who the media partners are and where sports media is going. So we're going to be going from traditional broadcast to betcast as well. So just knowing everything behind the scenes becomes an important part of staying abreast with what's going on.
Yeah, I think that's really important, Jim, because you as a sports commissioner destination may have a long-time relationship with a TV partner or media partner, and you need to be aware of who their betting partner is or if there is a betting partner. So, you know, you don't go into the planning meeting and, you know, put your foot in your mouth. So I think the media rights are coming fast and furiously. I feel like there's a new announcement on SBJ every other day. So I think that's important. And then how to leverage those potentially for promoting your destination is another great idea.
Yeah, and I'm gonna throw this question to Sara, but in the meantime, if anybody in the audience has a question that they'd like to throw out, now would be the time to type those into the chat box. But Sara, I'm trying to create events in my head that would be beneficial to tourism, sports commissions, across the country. But if I partner up with, let's say, DraftKings, they already have the ability and have set betting odds on certain events with mobile betting. But could I not create a competition where if it's March Madness, there's a $100 buy-in, I'm going to do a fundraiser for my local sports commission, and we're just going to see who does the best in the opening round. Well, that's already occurring, but I would still, if I'm going to do a special event, do I have to work with my regulator to get that approved?
Yeah. I mean, if you're trying to bank bets, mm-hmm. that would probably be an illegal gambling operation. So you need to be very careful around that. But if you wanted to host or sponsor in partnership with DraftKings, who would do something like that, you wouldn't need the regulatory approval to do that. The operator on something like March Madness that's, you know, widely accepted and there's permission to bet on NCAA, obviously the tournament, then that would just be some sort of event that, you know, you would host with an operator in partnership. But no, you wouldn't want to lead as a sports commission or anything like a gambling event.
Yeah, okay. And I guess the thing that I'm intrigued about are gambling competitions. Are we going to see more of that? Because I can get into a pool with DraftKings and have 250 people online betting on the same thing if it's a golf tournament, but going to a live sports betting competition just seems to be a whole new environment and experience at the same time.
Yeah, I mean, I think that replicates probably a retail sports book in a way. I the gaming law, you have to be careful in just knowing what's out there and what they're presenting. And every state has different, especially around like charitable gaming, and sweepstakes, and you know, every state has a different regulatory structure around that. And like even in Ohio right now, I know that they're debating like VFWs being able to have some sort of local sports betting machines. So we'll see where that all ends up, but that they're just different models in every single state. And I think to Jackie's point, like I would always err on the side of caution, especially mm-hmm. gaming, just because it is such a highly regulated space that you don't run afoul of the law. And so I agree, like courses like these are super helpful in getting your hands on that kind of information and seeking out expertise is really, really important.
Okay, Sara, I got a question from you, from one of our audience members. Reaction, what's the reaction been inside the gambling industry to Bally's now coming on board with the acquisition of Fox Sports Regionals? And I'm watching a Reds game the other day, and it's Bally's Sports Network. So you're continuing to see this closer merger with sports gambling and media. So what kind of reaction have you seen or heard?
Yeah, it's funny. I was having this conversation yesterday with someone, like the daylight between the sports industry and the gaming industry, the sports betting industry is like coming to a close. There just isn't much anymore. And the casino industry, you know, was honestly largely vilified. It was like, we don't want anything. And, you know, the leagues had pursued the court case to ban sports betting once New Jersey had, or not to ban it, but to keep PASPA in place once New Jersey had pursued its case before the courts on legalizing sports betting. So that obviously now that we have a legal regulated framework out there in a lot of states, that has obviously softened the ground now for a ton of league, obviously team partnership media deals. As part of that, and they've gotten more comfortable obviously with the concept and the idea of sports betting, so much so that Sinclair Broadcasting Group, who was actually a client of mine, has now integrated the Bally moniker as replacing the Fox Sports one. So it's funny because I think I was actually, where was I? It was, I feel like, I feel like I was somewhere in the Midwest, and I saw, so there was a baseball game on, and I saw the ballot. I was like, oh my gosh, it's crazy to actually see it in place now. But look, I think that the industry is not surprised. You know, years ago, I think at the right in the beginning, probably a year after PASPA had fallen, there was the announcement between Fox and the Stars Group at that time, which is now a part of FanDuel, but you know, that convergence of Fox Bet being out there, the Super Six now sweepstakes that people see every Sunday. I think, you know, we had seen this collision happening then for a while. I think, you know, it's probably caught some more people off guard that aren't in the industry to now see the Bally name associated with the RSNs. But I think, you know, it's not going away. They have a 10-year deal. Like, it's going to be in there forever. They're rebranded. And I thought it was really smart. That was obviously a highly coveted asset that the operators were super interested in because it is so hyper-targeted, obviously, to a segment of the population that cares about sports. So I think it made a ton of sense. And we'll see, you know, the success that comes of that.
This question for both of you, but I'm going to start with Jackie. Jackie, we've had a number of students take the course to grow their career and to seek, and they're now finding jobs in this vertical. But if I work with a state tourism or a sports commission, how am I going to benefit from getting smarter in the space? Because the space is going to get bigger. Are you going to see this to be part of the things that folks are going to list in their job descriptions in the future?
I think so, yeah. And again, I think it's a unique positioning point for the organization, for the destination marketing organization, to have a legalized gambling expert on staff. And I think, you know, not that you'll come away knowing everything and all things from, you know, three great courses, but I think you'll have such a great foundation and you'll have the resources to keep current on the industry because it's changing so fast and furiously. It's like, you know, trying to say you're an expert on social media. Nobody's an expert on social media because everything changes so quickly. But I think for me, it goes back to just adding one more level of service that a sports commission or destination marketing organization can provide to its many stakeholders, whether that's events rights holders, that's the community at large, the sports teams, new events, bringing new events into their portfolio, I think is just really interesting. So I think it's important myself, just because this is such a huge industry that has so many tentacles of impact. And if you're not in the game, I think you're just going to be left on the curb.
Right. And Sara, with a lot of the clients that you're now working with, looking into your crystal ball, where will the jobs be if somebody's really interested in growing their career within this vertical?
Yeah, you know, it's funny. I was speaking to the DC Commission yesterday, and this came up around small businesses. And just, I said, you know what, honestly, I would take a step back even. I think what is super exciting about now the legalization of sports betting, having been a career veteran, I guess, in the gaming industry, is that there's so much new talent now that's coming into the industry, which is amazing and awesome to see. And you see, you know, I think young, excited people that are looking at an entirely new vertical that has been just created, freshly created. So I think that on the technology side, there's a ton of opportunity. It's an industry, again, that is one of the last industries to move from retail now to digital. And that, again, hopefully is going to end up attracting a whole new slog of talent from, I feel like I have operators contacting me every single day about job openings. I know Hard Rock is hiring right now, furiously hiring. I think MGM is furiously hiring, because everyone's growing. Every single state now is coming online, and they've got to get in there, and they've got to have the team there to support them. And I think on the technology side, that is certainly an opportunity. I think from the sports side, having background in marketing is super helpful. You know, just across the board, I think that there is a ton of opportunity right now in this sector.
Yeah, and one of the things that we talk about in the course is the future of sports gambling, but in-game bets, prop bets, is really something, in my opinion, love to hear your thoughts, will continue to grow, and something that we're all going to have to watch to see what it does from a fan engagement standpoint and just in terms of making the industry grow. So Sara, do you want to maybe weigh in on the future of in-game bets, prop bets?
Yeah, I'm a huge proponent of in-game betting. I got in really early with a company called SimpleBet, which is the technology platform that provides the software then for in-game betting. So while in-game proposition betting, so micro betting. So while you're watching a baseball game, you see the next pitch coming. Is it going to be a ball or a strike? Are they going to strike out? Are they going to hit a home run? That type of betting, which, you know, going back to Jackie's point about fan engagement, this is a huge opportunity for the teams to capture eyeballs, to keep you engaged, to keep you interested in what is traditionally a very slow game. Golf, you know, I think being a big beneficiary of that as well. So I think that's where the future is headed. There are a lot of moving parts that need to come together in order for that to launch on a big national platform. But even in the District of Columbia right now, SimpleBet has integrated with Interlot for in-game in-play proposition betting. And, you know, if you were comparatively to look at the United States, which is in its infancy, to Europe, which has had sports betting for 20 plus years at this point, I think 70% of the bets that are taking place in Europe are in-play proposition betting, versus in the US right now, I think it's around 40%. So that trend will likely then continue here into that direction.
Jackie, any thoughts on in-game and prop bets?
Yeah, I'm, again, fan engagement all day long. I do see a question from Cedric and for Sara, but how does prop betting, how do you ensure the integrity, which, again, very important question.
Great question.
Yeah, I'm not sure that the answer would differ than for any type of betting. Here's the thing around in-game in-prop betting, in-play betting, is that first of all, the book is never going to take a bet that they don't think that they can't win. The old saying, the house always wins, is true. Although sports betting, it is a game of skill. So really, actually, 95% of the bets that are taken are given back to winners. On proposition betting, in-play proposition betting, these are not big bets. Like, they're not going to take a ton of money on them. They're going to be small micro bets. They're not going to, an operator is, their entire job is to manage risk, managing risk from a financial and monetary perspective. And then obviously from a reputation and an integrity perspective. So it is in their best interest to make sure that the bets that are being offered are, there's nothing nefarious that's happening. They always have the ability to shut down the bet. They always have the ability to not pay out if there's any suspicious transactions that have occurred and they've done investigations and found that something nefarious was happening. But around integrity, again, these are, if you thought that a player was going to throw a pitch or throw a shot, not a whole lot of money to be made on that anyway.
Sarah, along that lines, the way most of the legislation is written, can an operator make an in-game bet only available to the live audience, or would they have to also make that bet available to the virtual audience?
No, it would be, ultimately, of course, you want to have the virtual audience participating in that, but that part gets, which is what's happening right now in the district. It's tough because you can't have latency issues. To think about, and again, broadcast too, is it runs slightly behind, which clearly would present a problem if you had someone in the stadium who was actually sitting in the game watching everything, and then you had someone outside the stadium and you had a 30-second delay and they've already seen, what the next play is going to be. So that would present an issue. But yes, all the technology that is needed in order to support that function in a real way, it does get difficult from a virtual standpoint, which is why it just hasn't launched as fast, I think, as everyone had hoped and anticipated. And it's going to take probably a couple years before we get to full scale on that.
Great. Well, it's hard to believe that we have already covered our hour. I see Scott coming back on board, but I want to thank you both for the contributions that you continue to make to sports gambling education, and wish you nothing but the best the rest of the summer, and look forward to staying in touch.
Thank you for the opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, Jim.
Thanks, everyone. Well, I just want to wrap this up by saying again, go check out sportsgamblingeducation.com, and for our sports ETA members, use the promo code SPORTSETA that you see here on screen. I'm really excited about some Fantasy Sports Gaming Association courses that we are launching with the FSGA. The first one is live right now. It's SGE 401, Introduction to the Fantasy Sports Industry. We've got two more coming this summer as well. And of course, thanks to all the sponsors and partners of the program, including US Integrity, Sign Education Services, and of course, the AECOM Center for Sports Administration at Ohio University. Thanks so much for the time and expertise for all our panelists. So Jackie, Jim, and Sarah, thank you so much for everything that you have provided today. Thanks all.